this programme of Music Around Us, we continue to look at developments in music, this time popular music. Melbourne Educational FM station 3RRR is housed in this terrace building in Carlton. Financially supported by tertiary institutions and subscribers, the station broadcasts many spoken word programmes on public affairs, psychology, the arts and science. One might expect a station such as this, with its educational image, to broadcast what is loosely termed classical music. In fact, very little classical music is broadcast. Random listening to the station usually results in hearing rock music, often what is called punk rock or new wave. This mix of rock and education reflects the impact of rock on campuses in Australia. We'll be speaking with station staff and volunteers about their activities and about the prevailing influence of what they describe as popular culture.
Hey, do folks, this is Ricky Vengeance coming at you on 3RRR 102.7 in stereo, definitely in stereo. It's 5 o'clock, time for Weck Folder Diddle, which is your weekly folky type show here on 3RRR. And to start off, we got none other than the good old Bushwhackers coming at you from good old Orgathella.
8:30 on 3RRR FM. You're listening to Jeff King with Music Matters tonight, and this evening we'll be looking at a recent article by Simon Frith on sexuality in rock and contemporary music. And for a kick-off, I thought we'd start with a bit of country music and Rachel Sweet with an Elvis Costello tune, Stranger in the House.
It's just gone 5 o'clock here at 3RRR, and you're listening to the Curtain Raiser program with Rod Bishop and Peter Cole.
Yes, good evening.
First up, the new Peter Tosh album and his disco version of Buckingham Palace.
3RRR station manager is Sue Matthews. She has been a professional broadcaster since completing a university course. Before joining 3RRR, Sue Matthews was an ABC radio producer. She told us about the beginnings of 3RRR.
Well, it originally started as 3RMT FM, which was one of the first public broadcasting licences, which was awarded to the Royal Melbourne Institute of Technology, which originally was the sole operator of the station. Then, at the time of the first round of full public broadcasting licence hearings in September 1978, we formed a consortium of educational institutions to run the station, and as a result of that, it changed its name to 3RRR.
What does 3RRR represent?
Well, it can be anything you like, I suppose, but at one level, it's the 3 hours of reading, writing, arithmetic, or maybe even reading, writing, rock and roll.
And at 3RRR FM on midday on a wonderful Sunday afternoon. This is the late, late breakfast show for lounge lizards with Nardi. XTC, making plans for Nigel, social control. With a station staff of 10, supported by over 60 volunteers, programs are transmitted in stereo for 20 hours a day weekdays and for 24 hours at weekends. The newly acquired transmitter reaches all of metropolitan Melbourne, but the station can't afford ratings surveys. Audience response comes from telephone calls and letters to the station's monthly magazine, Radio City. The music programs are directed to an under 30 audience, many of them presented by volunteers. We asked station coordinator Nadia Anderson whether volunteers aimed for professional standards.
Well, we try for professionalism. We don't try for any other particular standard of professionalism than one that we've actually evolved ourselves. Obviously, a program is going to be less effective if the person is really fumbling with the operation of the console or with the ideas, if they're not clear and succinct. But we try for a certain amount of slickness, but that's not to cover up any sort of lack of content. That's simply to provide some sort of easy listening and accessible programming ideas.
You also have a certain presentation style or a vocal style in the presenters. Could you explain the significance of that?
Well, that's not something that's conscious. We're told that we have a triple R style. A few of us do sound similar, and that maybe is to do with having worked together for a period of time, having evolved a certain personality or a certain character that we are on radio to do radio. But we're not very conscious of it, and it's not something that we aim for. It's something that just happens somehow.
It's 2 minutes after 10 on a Wednesday morning, and this is Greg Pickhaver. Thanks to Helen Thomas for Talking Headlines. More news and views tomorrow morning at 8. But just for now, a bit of morning music mayhem, and starting off too cool to Calypso this morning, the number one record on 3RRR's Top 40, Nick Lowe and Crackin' Up.
There appears to be a fairly definite presentational style in 3RRR. Is that deliberate?
Certainly not deliberate. I'm interested that you say that, because, in fact, probably over half of our total time is presented by volunteers, and so they're not professionals, and they're all people who come in and just do one program a week. I'd really question that in a way. I'd suggest that there's a lot more diversity than you suggest.
Well, my title is Music and Volunteers Coordinator, and that entails, well, on the music volunteers side, meeting people as they come in with an idea for a show. If I think it sounds like it will work and they seem like they've got the knowledge and the resources to actually implement it, then I'll train them, which is not only in the panel, how to use the panel, but also in libel, slander, the rules that govern what we can legally do and say on radio, and also to have some sort of orientation towards the station and some idea of what we're trying to do as a radio station with an educational license, playing music amongst other things.
The station's programs reflect its audience interest in what is loosely called popular culture. We asked the station's staff to expand on the definition to give their interpretation of the meaning of popular culture.
If you're looking at any sort of culture, you've got to try and locate where the primary sources of the values and attitudes that the people in that culture have, what is the source of the myths and symbols and images that shape reality for people inside that culture.
Well, I think our understanding of popular culture is changing, and it's changed particularly since the war, because people have begun to look at it and see it as a particularly interesting thing that sort of ties society together. Now, that doesn't mean that that's new. That dates right throughout the whole of history, that there's been a popular culture which hasn't survived. But it hasn't survived in terms of, if you look at the Middle Ages or so on, because it hasn't had a means of being recorded. And I think that records are an important part of the recording of popular culture.
We have a very, very wide definition of popular culture in, say, a music context, which is what I'm best qualified to talk about. It's something to do with music that a large number of people, in fact, the majority or the mass of people respond to. Pop music has always been something that's been a focus for radio, for TV in some ways, and those sorts of media reflect what is happening popularly in culture and in society. And one of the most interesting things about all the music that's coming out at the moment that RRR focuses on is that sort of immediacy. If you think about the popular culture of a tribal society being the songs that tell of someone's death or, you know, crops failing or any particular piece of news that is of interest to the communities that surround that village. Well, you take the global village idea and all those things, like the social situation in England at the moment, which is reflected in new wave music.
There is no definition of popular culture as such. All you can see is that the spin-offs music have into people's lives and the way they run their lives and the sort of ways that music tend to reflect about people's lives and their way of thinking. And what we're trying to do is somehow tap into those notions and say to people, well, this is what you're listening to, and these are some of the forces that are at work helping condition your choices about the way in which you act. And it's those sort of things that really are what popular culture is about.
Is 3RRR a part of that popular culture?
Well, we want to be a part of it. We want to be reflecting on it, and we want to be providing a critical and discriminating basis on which people can judge it and make choices about the information that they receive from the rest of the culture.
The pop group The Reels, seen here performing at Melbourne rock venue The Crystal Ballroom, are playing at a concert promoted by 3RRR. The Reels describe themselves as a new wave band and come from Dubbo, New South Wales.
Why is 3RRR also involved in promoting rock concerts?
Well, one reason, obviously, is that we need to have some sources of income. The other, and probably the most important, is that we see ourselves as being engaged with the culture that we're trying to give some voice to. And Melbourne music has got a long tradition, Melbourne popular music, of being, you know, creative and exciting and experimental, but there's a vast array of music made in Melbourne that doesn't get any sort of commercial airplay, and a number of groups that never get to make records and so on. And we see that as a really important part of what we're doing, is to give some sort of exposure to those groups that don't get any other way of being heard by a large number of people.
People would go to a 3RRR concert?
Well, I think that some people are more interested in the spoken word programs, other people are more interested in the music programs, and there, some of them would be people who would go to concerts on a regular basis, others would be people who would listen to us and become interested in the music through hearing it on the radio and then be interested in following it up and going to see the bands. The most progressive, contemporary, exciting sort of developments are in the area that have generally been called New Wave. And that's really why we concentrate on that area, because we're trying to provide an alternative and provide some indications of the other sorts of things that are going on and that could be going on in the popular music area. I suppose, in a way, it's what we're trying to do in the intellectual ideas sort of area as well. We do want to be a cutting edge, if you like, of both ideas and music.
Hello, it's Bruce Milne here. Welcome to another edition of Sidetracks.
Bruce Milne has a vast collection of records, many of which he plays in his weekly programme on New Wave Music.
But let's start off now with the Buzzcocks and track off their last album, Ever Fallen in Love.
Bruce, you've said that punk rock first influenced you in about 1976. What was it about that kind of music that gripped you?
I was interested in music before, and there had been very strong things that had happened in music. There'd never been something for someone of my age. When I was 16 and 17, I wasn't very interested in the big, huge groups that had come out of those other eras and were still around. And then all of a sudden there were all these groups that were just amazing, and all of a sudden my favourite records were records that were a couple of weeks old, as opposed to old hits and things like that.
Of course, the Sex Pistols were at the forefront of that movement. Sure. What kind of things were a group like the Sex Pistols saying to people of your age?
Rejecting a lot of old values, or saying let's reassess things and look at things again. There were so many things I said. It was just an atmosphere of let's get back to roots, let's be honest. Don't take anything too seriously. Don't believe what you're told without investigating it a bit further.
Did that affect you personally?
Yeah, it did.
In what way?
Well, the new wave thing is it's a bit hard to sort of now sort of see the definition of new wave as particularly meaningful in the way that people would relate to the Sex Pistols or the Clash. It's come along, well, it's changed a lot since then, and I guess new wave as an idea is receding, and a lot of music now is coming out in electronic areas, in sort of with electronic instrumentation and an interest in sort of different forms, or going back to earlier forms of music like rockabilly or conventional pop music and so on. So there's quite a lot of varieties that I'm interested in, as well as what would be described as new wave.
Well, I think it's very difficult to develop a definition around new wave music, but if you look at it historically, it's post-punk music, and you tend to, I mean, with punk music you've got that very definite direction, social and political direction, that came out of the punk movement, whereas I think in new wave with music you tend to get a lot more groups that were sick of just perhaps twanging their guitars and realized that they could make other sounds other than two or three chords. So you tend to get a lot more things happening musically in new wave music.
3RRR, in the minds of many people, is most commonly identified with new wave music. Does that account for the fact that there's a lack of classical music in the 3RRR programming?
Well, the only reason that there's no classical music is because, really, we haven't had anybody offer to come and present a program in a suitable sort of style, and that presents the music in a context in the way that we try and do with our other music programs. What do you mean by a new wave station? I'd be dubious about that sort of categorisation.
We don't do a lot of classical music programming, mainly because that's covered by other FM stations, and part of the brief of a public broadcaster is to do something that isn't being done elsewhere.
Cracking up, I'm getting ready to go, had enough.
The BBC Overseas Service, in its English for Learners series, uses the lyrics of pop songs to help foreign listeners learn English. Some literary critics believe there is a new generation using music as the major form of communication. Is there a possibility that pop lyrics are replacing literature?
All around me, shaking hands and saying howdy. I don't think it's funny no more.
Do you think popular music has become the new literacy?
Yes, in a way. I mean, I think over the last 10 years, popular music has taken the place of, well, not taken the place, but made inroads into the area that literacy, and I guess you're talking about books and writing and the ability probably to be able to converse as well. I think that popular music has made inroads into that, but I think it's stabilised now. I don't think it is increasing. A lot of the people that I teach who are in their early 20s, even younger, I think relate to music as a language in a way that I didn't. I related to it. Oh, I did relate to it as a language, but it was a very big new language, the language of rock and roll during the 60s. And I think that sort of has established itself with a lot of other sub-branches to it, not just straight rock and roll, but jazz fusion, reggae. I mean, everything seems to be mixed much more these days than it was. And for those reasons, I think, yes, it has made inroads into what previously we would have regarded as literacy.
I don't agree with the academic position on that. I don't think that that's somehow harmful, and that we're losing a generation to the record player or something like that. I just don't believe that if that's what you mean by literacy, then I don't believe that that's what's going on. But I do believe that there are people who have made records who are as significant cultural figures as T.S. Eliot or who else? Ezra Pound were for their generation. I mean, I think that the form and the technology fit so neatly together in rock and roll that you have this form of dissemination of people's ideas and attitudes through music, that I think that it is, in that area. But I don't think that you can say that somehow people aren't interested in reading, or they're not interested in sort of the world around them, which literacy opens up for them. I just don't think that's true at all. I think, if anything, that people may be even, as much interested in that as they ever were.
I think at one level people have always been afraid that the arts of conversation and literature and the good things of Western civilization were about to decline and fall. I noticed that Penguin are just republishing a book that was first written in the 30s called The Decline of the Reading Public or something of that sort. I think the thing is that I suppose the cinema and popular music are the predominant art forms of our time. But I don't think in any way that they can replace literacy. No, I don't think that's on at all. I see them as being complementary rather than exclusive.
Do you think the kind of things that they're concerned with are as serious as the kind of things that perhaps literature is concerned with?
I think sometimes they are and sometimes they aren't. I think that the best popular music, like the best cinema, is concerned with the same sorts of things as the best literature. One of the problems, of course, is that you're comparing a relatively ephemeral, changing sort of form in any one year, say, with the best of the last 400 or 500 years. If we're comparing, you know, the great works of literature with popular music, because popular music we're seeing, you know, right now around us, and it's a bit unfair to compare what exists at any one time with, you know, the product of 400 years of Western civilization. I think only some of it will last. I think it's a relatively small proportion of it that will survive on the cosmic scale, if you like, just as in Shakespeare's time, I'm sure there were a lot of rubbishy plays being written that we don't bother to read now.
So who's the Shakespeare of New Wave?
New Wave? I don't know. I think the best of probably Elvis Costello, Nick Lowe, they're the people I find most interesting, and the Sex Pistols. Rather than Shakespeare, though, I'd compare it more to the 1890s. I'd see Johnny Rotten as, the Baudelaire of our generation rather than the Shakespeare.
Vengeance is one of the volunteers who doesn't specialise in rock music. His weekly folk music programme is presented in a breezy style.
I have very definite opinions of what I like, but I'll try and present as broad a spectrum of folky type music as I can, because I figure there's slews of people out there who won't, you know, have any other way of listening to folky music other than, say, on my shows and one or two of the other folky shows that are around town.
If you're playing such a wide variety of records, where do you manage to get all the records from to play on the programme?
I bludge them off my friends. I borrow them everywhere I go, beg, borrow and steal, stuff like that. I have a couple of records of my own too. I'll get a lot of people too. I'll say, oh, have you got any folky stuff? And they'll say, yeah, I've got this, but then I've also got this that you might not know about. Why don't you play some of this? And usually it works out pretty good.
Do you have much commentary in the course of your programme?
Yes, I tend to blither a lot. I tend to, some of the records I just don't have a chance to listen to beforehand just because of time, and so I'll be queuing up the stuff on the other turntable, and then I'll sort of catch on to what's being played and find something really interesting, a weird instrument, a harp or a dulcimer, and so I'll comment on that. I'll talk about, you know, where the instruments come from, why does nobody else in the city play them, stuff like that.
To a lot of people, folk music is associated with some kind of political consciousness. Is there any kind of political motivation in what you play?
Not really, no. I'm very, very apathetic politically. I'll play political songs, but I won't throw any political comments into it because I'm not really that interested in it at all, no.
How would you say your folk music program rates in comparison, say, to the ABC FM program?
I think I've got a lot more variety. I think the ABC tends to a more sort of traditional, possibly Australian, although I play a lot of Australian stuff too. But I think I tend to a greater variety, a lot of sort of more contemporary people. There's a lot of bands that are around now that are very musically trained. They're not the sort of the old pub session type people who just go in and have a jam, right? They'll heavily arrange their music, and I'll try and push those people as much as I can.
Surely rock and roll or popular music is the greatest form of manipulation that a young person can be exposed to.
Yes, exactly, and we want young people to be aware of that, and that's part of our role as an educator that sees music as being one of the forms of popular culture that most people are manipulated by. We see our role as being in some way to show that to young people, that they are being manipulated, and show the ways they are being manipulated by popular culture.
If that's true, is not 3RRR also manipulating certain ways of thinking about rock and roll music?
Yes, but hopefully we're doing it by saying media is manipulation. The media uses you in this way, and what we're doing is presenting you with all this information about the media and about your manipulation, and, you know, you make of it what you will.
Well, we're certainly part of the media, yes, just by being on the radio dial. We're a big part of the media, and we've taken it as one of the responsibilities as an educational broadcaster to take account of that.
The Fabulous Nudes with I'll Be a Dag for You, Baby. And it's off that old LP, or relatively old, I suppose, with the Auto Drifters and when the Relaxed Mechanics meet the Fabulous Nudes and the Polacco Brothers. I think they're all fairly old, disappeared type groups. It's now 19 minutes to 9 o'clock.
One of the most important functions of the station, I think, is to try and give to people who would not otherwise be in touch with it a sense of the sort of intellectual possibilities that are available to them. And there's an enormous number of people who have no direct contact with tertiary education. And I think if we can try and break down the ivory tower sort of idea of education in our society, then we're really fulfilling our function in the most valuable sort of way.
Does that mean that you're using popular music as a bait?
Well, I'd try and avoid that formulation of seeing the music as a sort of sugar coating for the educational pill, because in our music programming we are trying to encourage people to discriminate, to make choices and judgments, and to have that experience of choice and of, you know, making intellectual decisions that is an important, you know, vital part of education.